Our third unit in this course is about the memory of the Cold War borders and the memory of the Iron Curtain in Europe. So why do I think that this is important and this is should be our next topic for the discussion? So in my eyes, we all live in this post-Cold War world, right? And the fall of the Iron Curtain was an event which kind of marks the beginning of the new era we still live in. So the Iron Curtain is on the one hand a kind of very powerful symbol of the 20th century division of the world and especially of Europe into political blocks. It was one of the most stable, actually, borders, which for several decades was severely controlled, hardly permeable, and it's a kind of archetype of the border, if you wish. So when we think about borders, we often have in mind these images of strongly protected, wired borders with the border guards. Some of these images we inherited from our children's childhood, from our books we read as children, films we saw as children, from the whole kind of pop culture, Soviet pop culture, where the topic of protecting Soviet borders was a very prominent one, right? On the other hand, the Iron Curtain, the fall of the Iron Curtain symbolizes the victory of the free world over communism, right? And it's not just geopolitical victory, it's very much like moral victory, because the system which kept its citizens locked inside protected borders, did not allow them to travel, was somehow doomed to fail. Yeah, you are going to fail if you are afraid to let your people travel, let your people see other countries. And in the official narrative, in the mainstream narrative in today's Europe, this fall of the Iron Curtain, the fall of the Berlin Wall in a specific German case, is a very powerful symbol of the end of Cold War, the end of this kind of political division of Europe, is a symbol of final, like, reunification of Europe, but it is also a symbol of freedom of movement as a human right, which the idea which emerged during the Cold War, that human beings have this right to move freely, to cross borders, and those regimes which try to prevent this, try to keep people inside, or even shooting people when they are crossing borders, these regimes are criminal. And this is the state violence which is applied at the borders of such states, yeah, preventing people from crossing, shooting them while crossing borders illegally. these regimes are in the past, and they should be historically should be denounced as criminal regimes, right? The Iron Curtain is also a symbol of, as I said, of the reunification, the European enlargement, because the overcoming this division and bringing two parts of Europe together is seen as a kind of a final achievement of Europe's complicated 20th century history, as a kind of undoubtedly positive symbol. Yeah. So we are talking about the enlarged EU, about Europe reunified again after the decades of the political division of the continent. So it's also a symbol of free and united Europe. And the Iron Curtain, we talked about sites of memory. Yeah? The Iron Curtain is one of such European sites of memory. So it exists in the memory of many European citizens of European countries, especially, of course, those who lived near this this border, had to cross it, or not, were not allowed to cross it, and so on. And in the German case, it's also very important national site of memory, right? Because it's a symbol of the decades of the division of the country and its reunification. And especially for Berlin, as a formerly divided city, is on the one hand, is a kind of the disappearance of the traces of this division is celebrated as a kind of sign of reunification and newly acquainted German unity. On the other hand, as a reminder of this division is an important, the memory of this division is important to keep, to learn certain lessons, not to forget, and so on. And we talked about various political actors involved always in memory politics. And here too, we can see that, we will see that there will national governments, states, but also local communities, villages, towns near the border. Tourist industry is also a very important actor. But also associations of those people who, for example, in Germany, associations of relatives of the victims, those who were shot by crossing the German border illegally. So these are all different actors involved in commemoration of the Iron Curtain. And now I want to offer you a video, short video. I propose to watch it I don't know what does it mean. Watch it carefully, and we later we will discuss it, right? So I don't know. What you are going to see is the so-called Green Belt. And Green Belt is a kind of project, transnational project, which emerged as an answer to the question how to deal with the remnants of the Iron Curtain, of this strictly fortified, heavily fortified, strictly controlled border, which is engraved in the European landscape. What to do with this stripe of land, sometimes it's quite considerable, because as you know, there were like 5 kilometers along the border, any human activity, any economic activity was prohibited, and any settlements were not allowed. There were all kinds of fortifications and minefields sometimes, and wired fences, and so on. And what is going to happen with this kind of trace of this Iron Curtain? And this video is was created by the German tourist agency to promote what emerged from it as a kind of tourist destination. So please watch it, and later we will talk about what somehow you find interesting in this representation of this memorial. So what would you say? As you can see, the solution which was found for this strip of land is, in a way, it was lying on the hand. Yeah. So because of, for decades, this territory was kind of kept away from any economic activity, so it was just the nature was given freedom in this part of of the territory, and some of you maybe from those who are from Ukraine might have parallels with the Chernobyl zone. We often talk about Chernobyl zone as a kind of territory which, after so many years, it's a kind of a zone where the nature took over human remnants of the human activities. Yeah, so the kind of the nature recovers, and wild animals, various biological endangered species, they come back, and the nature is flourishing and kind of recovering. And this was used in making this remnants of the Iron Curtain into a tourist attraction. But I wanted to ask you how you so how did you see this video? What maybe some of the rhetoric used in this video or some images you would like to comment on?
I think at least what I saw as our children, it's about future. So taking future into this issue. So that's what I
first. Right. And one can see some remnants of the Iron Curtain, yeah, some towers and fences, but the images are black and white. They are like a photo, so, the image from the history, something which does not exist anymore. It's just a photo. And then the colorful images like continue, and it's actually very few of these images of the Iron Curtain. It's much more about now and about the future. And you're right, the children, but also they are talking in these voices in the background. It's free to enjoy the ride. So it's the idea of mobility, of moving, of traveling, of kind of unrestricted movement.
So just kind of to offer like a critical memory eye, since this is what we're talking about on this video, I think they used the word free like well over 15 times.
Yeah.
They use phrases like, this is a quote, place where time stopped, and now that the walls have fallen, a rich oasis has been unveiled. This is the same kind of rhetoric that still happens in Western Germany about Ostens today. And it kind of is this notion that all of Germany is on the same page and we're opening up something new. And the imagery of Germany proper is coming from the West, most of what I saw there. So I think this is this kind of overlooking of different paths and trying to create an artificial future going forward, pretending that those inequalities and differences aren't there.
Yeah. You also, in this video, you cannot see, so to say, two sides, yeah? It's just an image of one space, and you could not guess, even if you see some parts of the cultural landscape, you cannot say, was it East or West? So it's an attempt to present this space as a kind of united and without any traces of the division. Someone else maybe?
I would also like to add, because for me it was like neutral, like just landscape, just natural, sea and forest, it could be like everywhere, and only this memory side, there was not that much, only a little bit of castles, a little bit of city, that I could not say where exactly it is, maybe someone could say. So it was very general idea of this reunion, so.
Yeah.
no memory, including that, but we are like free to travel. So
yeah, yeah. And it says a path through history and culture. So what used to be a border is now a path, right? Traces of the past remain and feed our mind and consciousness. And here it's, they do not elaborate on this, but somehow implicitly we are gently invited to learn about these traces to feed our mind but also consciousness, so that we are as citizens we are invited to learn about our difficult past, so the word consciousness comes in, but it's a very kind of gentle invitation, so you should not be scared as tourists that you have to do much of moral work. So I found it very interesting, this kind of project, and it goes actually through the whole Europe. It's a kind of bicycle route, so you can bike along this this path, not only in Germany, but it's also at the border of Austria with the Czech Republic, and it goes on to the south, and it's a kind of transnational project. And it's interesting that this project was not at all controversial. So this is a form of memory. Actually, nobody really opposed this. And in Germany, the idea of this project emerged even before the reunification of the Eastern and Western Germany. And if you had the chance to look in one of the texts I offered you, it's about exactly this kind of form of memory, and it gives you some background about this project if you are interested. So it's a form of memory which is a kind of the way to remember the past without indulging into its traumatic sides. Yeah, and it's also, of course, this image of the nature kind of taking over is for us, it's also a symbol of amnesia, right? It's ruins taken over by nature is something which lies back in history, something which belongs to history, not to present anymore. So to allow somehow the nature to take over is something which also symbolizes this approach: let the past stay in the past. Yeah, we kind of overcame it, and the present is free from these awful things, right? So that's why it's also interesting to know that there were some voices raising concern that this kind of form of memory, it's rather a form of oblivion. Yeah, so you actually let the past die in this way, and the memory of the victims, the memories of those who suffered, they are kind of covered with this wild vegetation. That's why I think it's interesting to look into other forms and other projects of remembering the Iron Curtain and remembering the Berlin Wall specifically. I brought some tourist prospects I collected a long time ago, actually, when I traveled in Germany, and one of them, it's a tourist brochure called The Berlin Wall, right? And it has a history, a kind of brief narrative of how the Berlin Wall was built and the conflicts around it and how it was fallen, and also what became of it now. I will just pass this so that you can have a look. And there are also more of such tourist materials which are related to smaller memorial sites and museums in other places in Germany along the former Iron Curtain, like Marienborn, checkpoint Marienborn, Grenzdenkmal, Hüttensleben, Grenzland Museum, Eichsfeld. Yeah? So there are many such projects in Germany now. There is also Checkpoint Charlie in Berlin. And this is an attempt to save for the future parts of this Iron Curtain infrastructure and create also some kind of documentation centers where people could learn about how this Iron Curtain functioned, what was the border control, how the everyday life of the border guards looked like, what were the procedures of border crossing and so on. So it's kind of considered part of the recent German history, very important part, and something to be remembered. So I will just pass it. You can have a look, but please give it back to me. And maybe some of you had a chance to read the text I suggested for this lecture is by Anna Saunders, Remembering Cold War Divisions, Wall Remnants and Border Monuments in Berlin. Did someone had a chance to look into it? Yeah.
We all had a chance.
Who used the chance? Yeah, who used the chance? So talking about Berlin, right? We can see, you will have a look and you will see that this is, of course, more politicized forms of memory and compared to this Green Belt project. Especially Checkpoint Charlie. Who was in Berlin? Have you seen Checkpoint Charlie? I think it's difficult to miss, right? It's in the very center of Berlin. It's Friedrichstrasse, and it's there is this museum of the Berlin Wall, which is very interesting project with quite some history. But there is also kind of commemorative landscape in around it. So it's the whole crossroads. It's a kind of saturated with various memorial sites and projects and posters and exhibitions and a lot of tourists. And you have this checkpoint reconstructed, and you can make a photo with the someone dressed in the Soviet uniform and. And so it's a kind of interactive site where you can somehow experience, not really seriously, but kind of try to experience what and imagine this division of the city and this experience of crossing the border. You probably know that Checkpoint Charlie was meant not for the ordinary citizens, but for the military and then diplomats. And so this was like a VIP crossing point. And the museum, which is near to it, is very interesting because it emerged before the wall has fallen, and it was created by those enthusiasts and activists who worked as helpers, helping those who wanted to cross the border somehow to get to the other side. And these activists, they also collected all kind of devices and equipment, how you can call it, what people used to cross the border. If any of you went to this museum, so you might remember, it's a kind of very inventive ways people used to cross this highly controlled and fortified border. And of course, it's a very political kind of memory, yeah, where the border, the Berlin Wall is presented as a symbol of division, a symbol of oppression, and those crossing it sometimes being shot by the border police as victims of the oppressive political regime of the GDR. There is also another important memorial site in Berlin. It's in Bernauer Straße, maybe some of you also went there, where the local authorities just left part of the Berlin Wall intact and recreated kind of landscape, security landscape around it, so you can see the border, how it looked like. And in the rest of the city, of course, this border has disappeared.
So there's an interesting border in Berlin, Bridge of Spy, which is also some kind of segregation of two geopolitical worlds,
right,
two different world orders, mm-hmm, and the vivid evidence of Cold War.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in Berlin, of course, as a city divided by the Iron Curtain being in the heart of these Cold War divisions, you have on one hand the wish of course of the German population to kind of overcome this division and to forget about this division, and also the intention of the political elites in Germany was to do everything to reunite Germany. Yeah? So you have to kind of bring two countries together and create one nation of it. On the other hand, it's a kind of symbolic landscape of the Cold War, and millions of tourists come to Berlin to exactly attracted by this image of Berlin as being in the past a divided city, right? The Bridge of Spies, the Checkpoint Charlie, Bernauer Straße, where, as I said, they also recreated the church, which was staying there before, but it was blown up by the East German authorities because it was somehow in the security stripe. And this church was recreated as a symbol of reconciliation and German unity. And you have also a documentation center where the reality of this border is somehow documented, and the knowledge about it is somehow stored for the future generations, right? So it's part also of educational projects in Germany, how citizens should remember and learn, children should learn about their recent history. In the text I offered you to read, the author discusses two different projects in Berlin and two types of memory. One it's called Freiheitsmahnmal, right? So it's called in English could be translated as a memorial of freedom, something like that. And it was a temporary exhibition with crosses at the checkpoint Charlie, symbolizes those who were shot while crossing the border. So one cross for one victim. And this kind of memory, which imposes a very kind of monolithic narrative about what this Berlin Wall was and what meaning we should inscribe in the memory of this border, namely a repressive symbol of a repressive regime, criminal regime, right? But she opposes this project to another one, which was more like artistic and cultural, and it was called Übergänge. Übergänge is crossing points, and the idea was to invite artists to somehow to reflect on the idea of crossing point being like a in various senses, like crossing from one side to the other, but also crossing point as a kind of symbol of transition. And what emerged from this is a more kind of fluid, decentralized memory, which rather invites to reflect and think about own experience of border crossing, but not kind of imposes already written narrative on you. So I think it's a very interesting kind of idea how the same phenomenon can be commemorated from various perspectives and with various purposes, depending on who does it, yeah, whose memory is represented and with what purposes. And in fact, it's very important that this plurality of memories is given enough space, I think. Maybe someone wants to...
When I was in the Berlin and visited this museum, I was a bit surprised that you can not only commemorate the events, but also buy a piece of Berlin Wall and in such a sense consume the memory. So, I mean, I was a bit surprised because they've got a special lab in the museum or special space that people are destroying the huge pieces of the wall to a smaller one, and you can buy it from, I don't know, 1 euro till 2000, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's very interesting. So that the Berlin Wall, it's a symbol, yeah, but at the same time it's a very material thing, consisting of concrete, of beton. So kind of possessing this material object, piece of the Berlin Wall, is something like also a form of connect to this historical event, yeah, and historical phenomena. And here you can see that it's like turning Berlin Wall into a souvenir, yeah. Like, of course, this is part of the tourist industry, that something which makes it attractive, so you can go to this museum and take piece of the Berlin Wall with you. And again, one can discuss if this is the right way to deal with this memory, and if in this way we are not kind of turn this memory into something just the English word harmless. What is harmless in English? something not not dangerous anymore, not invested with this initial political meaning of part of the oppressive apparatus. So the question is how far this kind of commercialization of memory should go. We also have in Ukraine some projects where some people started to collect now with the decommunization and Soviet monuments being the monuments to Lenin and other leaders of the communist regime being destroyed. We have some people who maybe some of them are artists, others are just do it for curiosity. People started to collect, I don't know, remnants of these monuments. And it's probably always like, on the one hand, the wish to destroy and to erase, and on the other hand, any kind of urge to keep something, piece of it as a reminder, piece of something which is going to disappear. I wanted to show you something else, but I don't know, for some reasons my computer is probably fell asleep. Okay. So back to my second home country, Austria, I wanted to show you another project which was not kind of national. It was initiated by the local community. Austria has a border with Hungary, right? And this is called Andauer Bridge. Andau is a small village in Austria, right at the border with Hungary. And it's actually very kind of picturesque landscape with a lot of vineyards. And Andau is a village where people usually go to buy local wine. And it's also very kind of landscape for hiking and spending like weekend with children. So Andau, this village, they have a website for tourists where they kind of proudly show their attractions. And one of the attractions is the Andau Bridge, which is a bridge which in after the First World War it connected Austria and Hungary, and the border goes along this. It's a channel, it's not even a river, it's a channel. And then after the Second World War this became part of the Iron Curtain, right? So it was highly protected. It was highly permeable for ordinary people. And this is the channel which separates Austria and Hungary. And this is the road which goes from the village to the border. So what you can see here, it's like, these are pieces of art, yeah? So made of wood, these are, how do you call it, border posts, right? With, border guards, looks like that. So the guy inside is, I don't know why he's wearing shorts and not trousers, but this is the guy inside is the symbolizes the this control, border control, with the Soviet star, red star on the top. So what does it mean? Yeah, what and why actually this pieces of art are there? In 1956, there was an uprising in Budapest, right? And as this uprising was brutally repressed by the Soviets, and the Soviet tanks entered Budapest, thousands of Hungarians were fleeing the country. And many of them were crossing the border exactly at this point through this bridge. And the Andauer community, the Austrians, they organized kind of committee for which did local kind of help committee, right, to deal with the needs of these refugees crossing the border and fleeing from the Soviets. So people were given like food, they were given shelter for the first days, they were kind of welcomed on the Austrian soil. And today the inhabitants of Andau, Austrians, are very proud of this site. And what I'm going to show you is these are some images of from the Andau, how this looks like now, today, and how also like local tourist industry presents this for people who visit Andau to buy wine, basically. Yeah, so in the 90s, this narrative of Austrians helping Hungarians to escape from the Soviet regime, it was used kind of to reinforce this idea of the Austrian-Hungarian historical ties and friendship. And the association from both sides, the associations of those who fled the country or their relatives and like local community in Andau, they invited artists to create some work of art to commemorate this event. So this road was called Fluchtstrasse, the road for escape, yeah, to escape, I don't know. And you can find there some works of art. And this is, of course, presenting again the repressive nature of the Soviet or communist Hungarian regime. But of course, it was also because the border was controlled not only by Hungarians, by the Soviet army, and at some point they blown up this bridge to prevent people from leaving Hungary. But people were still living, like crossing the country. Crossing the channel without bridge. Yeah? So the images refer to this brutality of the regime and the victims, the refugees who suffered from it. And here is the memorial sign put to commemorate this event. Another kind of information table for the tourists in various languages, including Hungarian, German, English and so weiter. So it's about the bridge. The bridge was restored in 1996 to commemorate the 40 years of this uprising, and it should be as the table says, it should be a reminder of these events and the symbol of helpness and tolerance. Symbol as a foundation of free Europe. So this is more or less. Again, this is one of the commemorative signs, and more information about who who was involved in the reconstruction of this bridge. These are local communities on both sides of the border, and it was constructed by the Austrian army as a gift to the local community. These are remnants of the former infrastructure of the border and the tower to observe the landscape, and various signs at the bridge that tell this story, this narrative of solidarity from the Austrian side and gratitude from the from the Hungarian side. So it's from the Hungarian side, it says, "Dear Austrians, you were the first to support us from the first minutes of our fight for freedom. You stayed on our side and helped us from all your forces," and so on. So you can see that this is also the way to remember the Iron Curtain, not as something which separated people, but this can be a site of solidarity and narratives of solidarity, mutual help, and borders can be regenerated in this way as places where people actually help each other and solidarize with each other. Yes, and Anna, how much time do we have?
Maybe like 40 minutes. Oh, no, sorry, half an hour.
Half an hour. Okay, and this presentation, this short story about Andal, I wanted to somehow to oppose to something different, and this is another event which happened last week when I was already in Kharkiv at one of the Austrian borders. It's the border with Slovenia, and the small town at the border is called Spielfeld. And Spielfeld, every Austrian knows, it was in Spielfeld where in 2015, in autumn 2015, Austria experienced this refugee crisis. So the refugees were coming through the Balkan route, and they were entering Slovenia, and from Slovenia they would try to cross the border at Spielfeld, and most of them wanted to proceed further to Germany. So the autumn 2015, as you know, everywhere in Europe, it was this moment when the European Union, but also like the European states, were unprepared for this situation. And for some moment, like, national governments lost control over the situation, lost control over the borders, and the flow of refugees was so that the border guards they had just to open the border and let people march inside the country. And this is more recent memories of the border in Austria, which also used to be like the Cold War border, but now both Austria and Slovenia are in the European Union. So this border was basically, in the last years, it was practically non-existing on the ground. So people could cross it. There was just signs saying this is Austria, this is Slovenia, but hardly any controls, and you did not need passport. Even you would not think about taking your documents with you when you cross this border. And suddenly, this crisis of 2015 kind of evoked completely new meaning of this border. And what I wanted to show you is a very short kind of report of what happened in Spielfeld last week. It was a major joint training of the Austrian police and Austrian army, some hundreds of, like 300 police, I think, 200 soldiers, kind of reenacting the situation of 2015 and with other policemen kind of pretending to be refugees and trying to enter Austria, and police demonstrating that this time they are ready to react in the right way. And this was, of course, not a commemorative event. It was meant as a Übung, as one says in Germany, so training, kind of preparing police units and military units for potential situations like that. But it was also meant as a symbolic event, yeah, because it was broadcasted everywhere in the media and in Austria and Europe as a sign, and politicians who were giving political speeches at this spot, and this was a minister of defense and minister of the interior, they were saying, we want to set a sign, yeah, that what happened in 2015 will not happen again. So never again. And we know what never again originally means. They were using rhetoric never again, the current Austrian government, in relation to 2015, the refugee crisis. And they were talking about trauma of the Minister of Interior was talking about trauma of 2015, of having the images of 2015, this uncontrolled flow of migrants entering the Austrian territory, as something to cope with. And this is again, it's a question, something I want to discuss with you, if we can talk about also about memory here. Is it something which is not meant as a commemorative event but still has this kind of partly this function? So
Sie befinden sich am Grenzübergang zwischen Slowenien und Österreich. Bitte bewahren Sie Ruhe. Nehmen Sie Rücksicht auf andere Personen, insbesondere Ältere und Kinder. Sie werden in weiterer Folge registriert und die Zulässigkeit Ihrer Einreise nach Österreich geprüft.
hat das österreichische Rote Kreuz mit einem Stützpunkt. Es wird alles getan, um für die Sicherheit zu sorgen.
So, I just wanted to show you this report from the Austrian border with Slovenia. And Slovenia, by the way, was actually protesting this show, because Slovenian officials said this undermines Austrian-Slovenian relations, this kind of one-sided performance, even if it's not meant against Slovenia, but still it's like reinforcing this border and presenting Slovenia as a kind of dangerous space from where this threat of uncontrolled migration comes from. So I wanted to show you this fragment in order to give you kind of idea that this meaning of the Iron Curtain we were talking today, the meaning of the Iron Curtain is something entirely negative, and the fall of the Iron Curtain as a symbol of opening borders, of freedom of movement, as a kind of human right, as an openness between European countries, right? So this narrative, which is very fundamental for the European Union, it has some limits, right? It has some limits, and we just see in the last couple of years, we see how populists coming to power in many European countries, how they actually not like openly dismiss this narrative, but kind of propose alternative narratives which underline the importance of borders as a symbol of national sovereignty, as a symbol of control over the territory, as a symbol of protecting our population against others, right? And all these new narratives which looked like in the first decades, post-Cold War decades, like marginalized and politically irrelevant, are coming to the fore again and actually are important in national politics of such countries as Austria, but not only Austria. So reintroducing border controls and renarrating borders again as barriers, as protecting us from them, right? So this is what I wanted to offer you for your thought and discussion, and maybe you would like to comment on it, or would you have questions, or comments? Okay, if we don't have immediate questions and or comments, I think we will come back to some of these issues we discussed today. We will continue tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, and we will have more opportunities to talk about this. And now I think, should we stop here if there are no questions or comments? So thank you very much.